Well, I was told that all the speakers have been introduced this morning. So, well, I'm Eckhard, and I was asked to do the second part of this introductory workshop, the second part on post-Keynesian economics. I see a whole lot of students, I guess, graduate students in the room, but I also see some more senior people. So don't be disappointed. I have nothing new to say, the seniors. So it's an introduction to post-Keynesian economics, so don't expect anything new. If there is anything new, or there will be anything new to say, I will save this for tonight, because I'm supposed to speak in the first plenary session, and I'm not sure whether I have anything new to say, but this is for tonight. So this this will now be a kind of introduction to post-Keynesian economics. I understand that we have 90 minutes, and I have prepared a kind of presentation in two parts, two blocks. I think I will try to use 30, 35 minutes for each block, so that we, after each block, we have, let's say, 10 minutes for questions and answers. The first block will deal rather with post-Keynesian economics as an economic school, as a heterodox school among other heterodox schools. And I will try to explain, first of all, what post-Keynesians have in common with other heterodox schools of thought, and to what extent post-Keynesian economics and other heterodox schools of thought can be distinguished from orthodox economics. I will introduce you to the strands of post-Keynesian economics if we take a broad tent view on what post-Keynesian economics is supposed to be. And then I will briefly go through the stages of development of post-Keynesian economics. This will be the first part, should cover roughly 30 minutes, maybe a bit more. And then in the second part, I would like to talk about main topics of post-Keynesian economics, and there are several, of course, and I've selected three important topics from my perspective. The first one is interest, credit, and money. How do post-Keynesians see this? The second one will then draw on or deal with income distribution and the principle of effective demand in the short run. I will try to develop a very simple short-run model driven by aggregate demand. And then in the last part, I will then come to the long run and give you a brief overview over income distribution and the principle of effective demand in the long run. So I will briefly introduce you to the main strands of post-Keynesian distribution and growth models. This should take another 30 minutes or so, and as I said, we should have 10 minutes or so after each part for questions and answers. Okay, let's start. You've already attended a lecture on the history of economics, and I'm not sure whether I'm consistent with Mrs. Algova, but this is how I see the different schools in macroeconomics, so now we're focusing only on macro, and how we can distinguish orthodox and heterodox schools in macroeconomics. So it all starts with the classicals, Smith and Ricardo. We then have Marx, who has drawn on the classicals and has changed a bit the conclusion from the classicals. And Marx is still a source of inspiration of modern Marxist schools. So the monopoly capitalism school, which you have in the US around the Monthly Review, the social structure of accumulation school, which is also mainly present in the US at the University of Massachusetts, in Amherst, and at other universities. And then in Europe, we have the counterpart to that, which is the French regulation school. So this is one modern school of macroeconomics drawing directly on Marx. Then we have post-Keynesians. Maybe I start from the bottom and move up again. Then we have the post-Keynesians. I will talk about them a whole lot in the remaining 85 minutes or so. And post-Keynesian economics has its roots in the Cambridge, UK, and the American post-Keynesians, which were, on the one hand, very much influenced by Keynes, of course, And on the other hand, in particular, the Cambridge post-Keynesians, people like John Robinson in particular, who were very much influenced by Michał Kalecki, the Polish economist who had discovered the principle of effective demand, which is the main building stone or the main foundation of post-Keynesian economics, even a couple of years before Keynes in the early 1930s. Now, then we have the orthodox, the modern orthodox schools. We have the new Keynesians, or what many of you know as the new consensus model, which has now made it into most of the textbooks. The new consensus model is basically a compromise between new Keynesian economics and the new classicals, but I would argue it's more new Keynesian than new classical. The new classicals are on the right-hand side from your side, people like Lucas, Barrow, and others. The new Keynesians, I've put some of the most familiar names in the box, so Blanchard, Mankiw, Stiglitz, but there are several others. Now, if you go back in the history of economic thought, and I'm sure you've done that in the previous lecture, we have had the old version of the synthesis between Keynes and the neoclassicals, so the neoclassical synthesis with authors like Hicks, Samuels, and Tobin, and as you as I'm sure you know from your undergrad and grad programs, we had the monetarist, or still have the monetarist, with Milton Friedman, and they can just be seen as different schools of neoclassical economics. Neoclassical economics, most familiar names are Marshall, Pigou, and Vixal. So if I'm talking about heterodox and orthodox schools in macroeconomics, what I have in mind is, on the one hand, the heterodox schools, so the modern Marxists, the post-Keynesians, and then on the other hand, the orthodox schools, which are the new Keynesians and the new classicals and the modern synthesis, new consensus model. Now, how can we distinguish heterodox and orthodox schools? And here I'm drawing a whole lot on the work of Marc Lavoie, who has 2 years ago presented the second edition of his Post-Keynesian Economics, a largely expanded version which covers almost anything in post-Keynesian economics up to date, so to speak, so up to 2014. And Marc, in his first chapter, makes a very helpful distinction between heterodox schools and orthodox schools, applying what he calls presuppositions, or the different presuppositions which these two type of schools are following. And let us briefly go through them. This is just the table with the overview. Let me just go through them and try to explain them in step. Now, the first distinction, according to Lavoie, is related to epistemology and ontology, so to the science of learning and the basic categories and their relations. And Lavoie argues that the heterodox schools are following what he calls realism. So he argues that the objective of economics, according to this perspective, is to tell relevant stories and to explain the actual working of the economy in the real world. Nicholas Kaldor has coined the words stylized facts. So economics should start from stylized facts, which we observe, and then try to explain the relationships between stylized facts, causal or interdependent relationships between these stylized facts. So we should start with stylized facts rather than hypothetical idealistic positions or assumptions. Now, instrumentalism is the counterpart to that, and as Lavoie argues, orthodox theories are based on instrumentalism, so the argument usually is that economic hypotheses are sound if they allow for the calculation of equilibrium and accurate prediction, irrespective of the initial assumptions. And since I guess most of you have gone through at least an undergrad program or even a graduate program, this is what usually is the starting point of neoclassical economics. Milton Friedman is the author in case. So this is the first type of presuppositions, according to which you can distinguish orthodoxy and heterodoxy. The second type relates to the concept of rationality. And again, following Lavoie, we have on the one hand the heterodox schools, which argue that economic agents, firms, households, individuals, face severe limitations in their ability to acquire and to process information. In particular, because this information is simply not known or not knowable. So you might have heard or read about this famous, it was an American politician, I think, who talked about known unknowns and unknown unknowns. And this is basically what Keynes had in mind when talking about uncertainty. So we simply do not know, as Keynes, 1937, argued in a paper explaining the core of the general theory. Now, this means that agents have to act nonetheless, although the future is not known and cannot be known. How do they act? Well, they have to build expectations, and these expectations are built on this radical concept of uncertainty, and therefore expectations have to be guided by norms and by institutions. Conventions, customs, rules of thumb, as a, well, in a sense, rational response towards these conditions. Lavoie calls this environmental and environment-consistent rationality, and agents are not optimizing agents, but satisfying agents. So agents have targets. If targets are not met, they respond, but it has nothing to do with the concept of optimization as it is employed in the orthodox schools, in which, as you know, it is assumed that we have hyper-model-consistent rationality, rational expectation, as it's called in the textbooks, and this, in a sense, assumes that the individuals possess unlimited knowledge and the ability to calculate economic outcomes applying the true model. So you need perfect information for that, and under these conditions, agents are said to have rational expectations. By assumption, you rule out asymmetries in terms of information, which had then been has been entertained, in particular in New Keynesian economics, and you rule out fundamental uncertainty, which is the cornerstone of post-Keynesian economics. With regard to method, we can again make a distinction between orthodoxy and heterodoxy, following Lavoie, and he argues that heterodox models or approaches by and large follow what he calls the concept or method of holism and organicism, which means that individuals from the start are seen as social beings which are under the influence of their environment, culture, class, gender. Institutions matter, therefore, and history matters. And from this, you can then also derive the micro-macro paradoxes which are characteristic for heterodox economics and for post-Keynesian economics in particular. I think the paradox of thrift is known to all of you, but there are other paradoxes which can show up if economic agents, firms, and households act rationally in a certain sense, and the outcome is then completely unintentional or irrational, if you like. So households save more in a recession, and at the end of the day, income will shrink, and therefore aggregate saving will not rise. We have the paradox of cost, which has been introduced by Mikhail Kaletsky. We have the paradox of public deficits, which is, what should by now be well known in countries which have gone for austerity in a particular harsh way. If you look, for instance, at countries like in the southern periphery of the Eurozone. So if you try to reduce government deficit, it means that private revenues and private profits will shrink. Government deficits and increase in government deficits will raise private profits. We have the paradox of debt, already included in Irving Fisher's seminal work, but then also highlighted in the work of Joseph Steindl, a post-Keynesian Kaletskian author, arguing that the attempt at deleveraging of major parts of our economy, in particular of the government, might lead to higher leverage ratios if you take into account the macroeconomic effects of this microeconomic behavior. And there are several other paradoxes. I don't have time to go through all of them. In Lavoie, you find an explanation for them. So this is heterodoxy. If you look at orthodoxy, the starting point usually is that you need to start your economic analysis from the individual. And the individual, so to speak, is seen as a pre-social individual, and society is only constituted by the interaction of these individuals. This is where the idea of micro-foundations of macroeconomics comes from, and also the argument that institutions and the development of institutions has to be explained based on rational choice, so to speak, of individual actors. Which is then in the extreme resulted into models in which you just have one representative agent representing the economy as a whole. And by assumption, you therefore rule out these micro-macro paradoxes which are characteristic for post-Keynesian economics. John King, an Australian post-Keynesian, has called this method or this approach a micro-reduction and not a micro-foundation of macroeconomics, because you rule out the characteristics which you may have if you apply this holism, organicism kind of method. Rule out the paradoxes which I've just mentioned. Finally, if we look at the economic core in orthodoxy and heterodoxy, you can argue that in the heterodox approaches, the core is usually production, growth, and Lavoisier also adds abundance. I wouldn't take this literally. I mean, it just means that the focus of economic analysis in heterodox economics has been, right from the start, if we go back to the classicals, has been accumulation. So to speak, the accumulation and the expansion of the output potential of potential output by means of capital accumulation and by means of technical progress. The classicals, therefore, have also always talked about reproduction prices. So prices have to be such that firms can recover costs, can make a profit, and the idea has been that out of these profits, firms are able to accumulate. Kaletsky and Keynes, roughly speaking, after the Treatise on Money, have then drawn the attention from the accumulation of capital, or have shifted the attention from the accumulation of capital and productive resources towards the utilization of productive resources, because under the impression in particular of the Great Depression, it became clear that productive resources, potential output, is not necessarily fully utilized, and therefore you have to explain the level of economic activity, you have to explain the degree or the rate of utilization. And that is where the principle of effective demand comes in, which I will talk about later a bit more in detail. Now, if you again look at the counterpart, if you look at orthodox theories, the starting point has been, in the history of economic thought, has been exchange, allocation, and scarcity. Lionel Robbins, it's not nothing to do with Joan Robinson, or, has put forward this famous definition of what economics is all about. So it's the efficient allocation of scarce resources. This is how neoclassical economics started in the last third, so to speak, of the 19th century. So you had a pure exchange model as the highlight, so to speak, produced by Leon Barras. And here prices are not seen as reproduction prices, allowing for reproduction and accumulation. Prices here are seen as reflecting scarcity. Exchange is the starting point of economic analysis, and production and growth has later on been appended to that. The famous solid growth model was only published in the 1950s. Finally, if we look at the political core, going back to Lavoisier's distinction, Lavoisier argues that heterodox economists usually come to the conclusion that we need to regulate markets, because markets generate instabilities irrespective of price flexibility or inflexibility. So even with flexible prices, you would see a lack of aggregate demand, you would see underutilized productive resources. Markets produce unacceptable inequalities, and markets produce inefficiencies. Generally speaking, heterodox authors usually hold that free markets as such are a myth, are impossible. Markets always need institutions to function. So the notion or the starting point of a free market or a market with perfect competition is a myth. Real markets are different from that, and real markets always carry the tendency towards undermining competition, the tendency towards oligopoly and monopoly. That's the micro level. At the macro level, markets have to be regulated, or we need state intervention into the market economy, because usually aggregate demand will not be sufficient to use or to make use of all the productive resources. Economies are facing an aggregate demand problem. If you look at orthodox economics, usually the political core or the political implication is that we have to adjust the markets of the real world to what we have in our models or in our textbooks. So we should make markets as perfect as possible, because perfect markets are said to generate optimal results. State intervention under these conditions would only generate inefficiencies. Of course, there are exceptions. I know that from your textbooks. As soon as you have external effects, then also in a neoclassical model, you may have an indication for government intervention. Now, this is how you can distinguish orthodox theories or orthodox approaches and heterodox approaches. Now, let me come to post-Keynesian economics as a specific school on the heterodox side. So together with the modern Marxists, if we look at macroeconomics, if we expand and enlarge and take into account microeconomics, we also have, of course, other approaches which we could add here. Now, what are the strands of post-Keynesian economics which we have? And again, following Lavoisier's book, we can broadly distinguish five strands of post-Keynesian economics. On the one hand, the first strand, these are the fundamentalist Keynesians, going back to the original work of John Maynard Keynes, also inspired by work by Harman Minsky, Joan Robinson, Shackle, and Sidney Weintraub. Lavoisier has the current authors on the right-hand side. I won't read them. If you look for a specific post-Keynesian, you will easily find him, and then you know to which strand, according to Lavoisier, he should belong. The major themes of the fundamentalists are fundamental uncertainty, of course, going back to Keynes, the monetary production economy, financial instability, and methodology. Then the second strand rather goes back to Mikhail Kalinsky, or the works of Mikhail Kalinsky, in particular Kalinsky himself, Joseph Steindl, but also the younger Joan Robinson, Donald Harris, Tom Asimakopoulos, and others. And the Kalinskians have as their major themes income distribution and growth, I would argue, effective demand, class conflict, and pricing in oligopolistic markets.
Yeah? Does older and younger relate to the time span or
To the age of Joan Robinson.
All right.
So when she was younger, she was more influenced by Kalinsky and also was more open towards formal modeling. And the older she got, the more critical she got, in particular with respect to formal modeling, and got closer to the fundamentalists, who are skeptical with regard to formal modeling, with regard to using econometrics and so on. Yeah? So this is related to her age, according to her. Then as a third school, we have the Sraffians. Of course, going back to the work of Piero Sraffa, you have some modern or some inspirations here, Luigi Pasinetti, Pierangelo Galignani, and others. And the Sraffians were mainly occupied, or still I would argue, with relative prices in a multi-production framework, with the capital theory criticizing the neoclassical notion of aggregate capital and the concept of a marginal productivity of capital, joint production and long-run positions of our economy when competition has generated an equalization of profit rates across sectors. Then we have two further strands, which are the institutionalists. The most popular, or the most familiar names, I guess, are Thorstein Veblen, Abel Lerner, the founding father of the concept of chartalism and functional finance, Alfred Eichner, John Kenneth Galbraith, and others. This is where a whole lot of post-Keynesian micro comes in. Theory of the firm, pricing theories, examination of monetary institution and institutions and their operation, and where also behavioral economics and post-Keynesian labor economics comes in. And at the fifth strand, according to Lavoie, we have the Caldorians, going back to the work of Nicholas Caldor, Roy Hobbs Harrod, Goodwin, Godley, and John Cornwell. And here the major themes are economic growth, productivity regimes, open economy models, in particular, based on Caldor in particular by Anthony Thurwald, the balance of payments constrained growth model, for instance, and others. Here also we have, with the work of John Godley, the models which explicitly link the financial and the real sphere of the economy in so-called stock flow consistent models. So these are the five strands. There are several authors. One is here, who is not in one of these boxes. Philip Orestes, you might want to ask him during the break to which box he would like to be put in. But there are others as well who are not put into these boxes. So this just gives you a kind of idea of the plurality within post-Keynesian economics, so of the different strands in post-Keynesian economics which we have. Now, do these strands have anything in common? There's been a debate in post-Keynesian economics, mainly Paul Davidson against many, many others. Paul Davidson, who has argued and who has been arguing for a long time, and one of the controversies, or the last controversies we've had was in the early 2000s, when Davidson wrote a critique of John King's book on the history of post-Keynesian economics, in which Davidson argues post-Keynesians should only, what he considers post-Keynesians, only those who strictly adhere to Keynes's rejection of the classical axioms. And the classical axioms, according to Davidson, interpreting Keynes, are the neutrality of money, the ergodic axiom, and the gross substitution axiom. So only if you abandon these axioms, then you are a post-Keynesian, according to Davidson. And he tries to explain why Kaletsky, why Minsky, why others are not post-Keynesian from his view. Now, I think this is, of course, a position which we have to respect, but this is not the way to go. I would rather follow Eichner, Kregel, Hamuda Harcourt, Philip Orestes, Marc Lavoie, and others who've argued in favor of a broad tent approach. Now, a broad tent approach does not mean anything goes. So we have to check what do these five strands, which we have coined or termed post-Keynesians, what do they have in common? Now, I would argue that there are five principles or characteristics which these five strands have in common and which therefore make them post-Keynesians, if they like. I don't force anybody to call himself a post-Keynesian, to be sure. The first characteristics which they have in common is the focus on a monetary theory of production, in which money is non-neutral in the short and in the long run. So money is not a veil. This goes back to Keynes, who had already claimed this in 1933 in his contribution to the Spitoff-Festschrift. The second, and therefore the, so we have the five the five presuppositions of heterodox economics, and now we have five characteristics of post-Keynesian economics. So the second characteristic of post-Keynesian economics, or the seventh if you add the first five, is that post-Keynesians of each strand would accept that modern economies are faced or are dominated by the principle of effective demand, both in the short run and in the long run, which means that effective demand does not only have an impact on short-run utilization rates or short-run economic activity, but also on long-run growth, even on productivity growth. Then we have a third or eighth characteristics, which is the importance of the notion of fundamental uncertainty. I already mentioned Keynes says we simply do not know, which is different from probabilistic risk. And this also implies that as a fourth or ninth characteristics, we have the insistence that economic processes take place in historical and irreversible time and are thus largely path dependent. In other words, there is no such thing as a predetermined, non-accelerating inflation rate of unemployment. There is no such thing as a predetermined potential growth. As Kaletsky famously argued that the long-run trend is but a slowly changing component of a chain of short-run or short-period situations. So the long run is just the average of what has happened in the short run. There is no long run out there to which the short-run dynamics will converge. And then the fifth or the tenth characteristics of post-Keynesian economics is the importance of distributional issues and distribution conflict for economic outcomes, for output, employment, inflation in the short run, and for growth in the long run. So if you add them, you have the 10 commandments of post-Keynesian economics. Now it's up to you whether you consider yourself to be a post-Keynesian, but I would argue this is what post-Keynesians have in common. Let me briefly, because I'm already used to when did we start? No, we started at 11:30, right? Yeah. So I still have 5 minutes or so, and then we can allow, we start a bit late. So I've used half an hour.
Half an hour.
Yeah, so let me use 5 minutes or so to give you a broad overview over the stages and the current state of post-Keynesian economics, and then we'll have a break for question and answers before I move on to the main topics. Now, what are the stages of development of post-Keynesian economics? But basically, well, I like the number five, as you see. We have five stages. So the first stage is, of course, the 30s and 40s, when Keynes and Kaletsky discovered the principle of effective demand and introduced this principle into macroeconomics. And the focus in this period was, of course, on involuntary unemployment, the trade cycle, and the development of the principle of effective demand. Then we had the 50s and 60s, and there we had, on the one hand, the further development of the principle of effective demand and the application of this principle to the long run meaning towards growth issues. And here, Caldo and Robinson were the first to go with their papers and books in the mid-50s. Caldo's paper 55, 56, and then models in 57, 61, sorry, and John Robinson's famous book, The Accumulation of Capital, in 1956. Later on, we had Pasinetti building on Caldor. So we had models which included the principle of effective demand into the long run, so into the distribution and growth issues. Simultaneously, we had the famous capital or Cambridge controversy, triggered by a paper by Joan Robinson in the early 50s, in which she asked the simple question, well, what, you neoclassicals, is capital? And the neoclassicals could not explain what capital is. At least they could not explain that the basic assumptions in their model, that the value of capital is independent of income distribution. Going back to Sraffa, the post-Keynesians could show that the value of capital is affected by distribution, and you had all these nice critiques of basic concepts of neoclassical economics, such as a falling demand function for labor or a factor price determined capital labor ratio. As we know, and we know that Samuelson, in his summing up paper, conceded defeat, but this has had no effect whatsoever on modern textbook industries. In the 70s, we then had what Giuseppe Fontana called the Romantic Age of post-Keynesian economics, so the search for a grand theoretical system, because under the influence in particular of the first a deep crisis of post-war capitalism, so the mid-70s crisis, people thought, or post-Keynesian thought, well, neoclassical economics is about to be replaced. We had Davidson's book already in 1972, then we had the famous paper by Eichner and Kriegel in the Journal of Economic Literature, trying to define what post-Keynesian economics is as an alternative to neoclassical orthodox economics. We had the foundations of the first journals, the Cambridge Journal of Economics, the Journal of Post-Keynesian Economics, still existing, and also highly rated, at least the CGE and several journalists. And we also had the development of a post-Keynesian microeconomics, so the theory of the firm and pricing theories, the works by Adrian Wood, by Eichner, and by Harcourt and Kenyon in particular. But as we all know, post-Keynesian economics has not replaced orthodox neoclassical economics. Instead of the neoclassical synthesis, which did not seem to be able to explain stagflation, we had the dominance of monetarism, and later on we had the new classical economics as a more radical version of the monetarist school, and the most radical version, the real business cycle school, denying any role for demand, aggregate demand, in our economies. On the post-Keynesian side, this led to what Giuseppe Fontana called an age of uncertainty, and post-Keynesians in this period went back to method. So you will find in the journals and in the books a whole lot of papers which deal with the question what Keynes meant, what Keynes really meant, what Keynes really meant, really, or even what Keynes should have meant. But we also had the first textbooks, or another vintage of textbooks, Philip Orestes, Marc Lavoie with the first edition of his Post-Keynesian Economics, Davidson, Tom Pally. In this period, we had endogenous money theory, in particular associated with the work of Basil Moore, but also other authors building on Kaldor. And we had Minsky's financial instability hypothesis, part of which was already published in the 1970s, but which became more popular in the 1990s. We had the first Kaletskian distribution of growth models as a second version of post-Keynesian models. Remember, we had the Kaldor-Robinson models already in the 50s and 60s, and then we had the Kaletskian models. I will come back to that in the last part of my presentation here and today. We also had further journals, the International Review of Applied Economics and the Review of Review of Political Economy in North America. And then we have the current period, I would say, which started, well, roughly in the mid-late 1990s and has lasted till now, in which we've seen more and more applied work. So post-Keynesians have started to do econometrics, which you do not find, at least not on a large scale, in the earlier periods. There were exceptions, of course, but now, with the younger generation having gone through the graduate programs, being forced to do econometrics with the computer programs, it became easier to do it, and we have we've seen a whole lot of applied work in conferences like this. In particular, on the area of distribution and growth. Second, we've seen also more formal work, more modeling work in the area of integrating money distribution or money finance distribution and effective demand and capital accumulation. Small-scale analytical models, but also large-scale so-called stock flow consistent models. applied recently or for the last 10 years or so, in particular to the issue of financialization. We have seen the development of full alternative models to the dominant mainstream model, which is or has been the new consensus model. Again, Philip Orestes has been on the forefront of that, criticizing the new consensus model and proposing alternatives. And we've seen a next vintage of textbooks, or at least collection of essays in post-Keynesian economics. You have the list here. So Hawkwood Chrysler, I've done a book with Engelbert Stockhammer based on the summer school of this network. There's a German textbook by Hein here. John King, Marc Lavoie have been very active in this area. And we have again for the journals, one of the journals which might have been introduced to you this morning already, the European Journal of Economics and Economic Policies Intervention, which is closely linked to this network. And we have also seen the new kid on the block, so to speak, the Review of Keynesian Economics. Now, I would argue, of course this can be contested, that we now have a solid body of theory and policy recommendations in the area of macroeconomics. We have, post-Keynesians have worked on all these areas and have provided more or less convincing alternatives to mainstream macroeconomics, based on new Keynesian and neoclassical economics. I don't want to go through, don't want to read all these areas to you. If you would like to get an impression, take a look at Marc Lavoie's book. This is, I think, the best overview, the best and most detailed overview you can get. Those of you who don't want to read, I don't know, 600 pages or so, those of you who would like to have a shorter overview over the current state of post-Keynesian economics, I can highly recommend John King's latest book, which is an advanced introduction in post-Keynesian economics. And of course, you can look at these collected essays in the books by Hawkwood Chrysler, by myself, and Engelbert Stockhammer, and by John King. Maybe I stop here and ask for questions and comments. None? Crystal clear? As usual, there is one question, please. Just speak loudly.
Yeah. Just for the 2010s years, who are not really mentioned yet, what would be your guess? In particular, would you tell about ecological things and limits and critique of growth? Would you include that in the next steps for the post-Keynesian theory?
I will talk about this tonight in the first plenary session, so I must disappoint you, so I won't answer your question right now, so to keep your curiosity till tonight. Other questions? If not, then just
can
let me.
Can I make a quick comment?
A short comment, Philip, because I'm already running a bit out of time. So.
A short comment because you said something about carbons.
Mm-hmm. Excuse me.
Nature is fact, which I think is very important.
You should use the mic.
Thank you very much. You made a comment about Cartor's proposition that stylized facts are important. I think that's extremely important in view of what you said earlier
about post-Keynesians
getting involved with empirical analysis. For if you don't make stylized facts, your theoretical proposition cannot be properly estimated, you know, your testable hypothesis, and consequently these are very important developments in terms of post-Keynesian economics. Thanks.
I fully agree with that, so thank you for supporting me on that field. Okay, so if there are no further questions, I would then move on to three important areas of post-Keynesian economics. Initially, I thought I could also talk about more the infrastructure of post-Keynesian economics, but I think you will just put this on the web And so you could just read, if you're not familiar with post-Keynesian economics yet, I have an overview over textbooks, I have an overview over journals in which you can get your work, or which are at least open to post-Keynesian economics, and about networks, association and conferences, summer schools, and finally about graduate programs which include post-Keynesian economics or are open to post-Keynesian economics. I won't talk about that for the sake of time. You could read that if the PowerPoints go online, or when the PowerPoints go online. Let me now talk about the three areas of post-Keynesian economics, and let me start with the first one, which is about interest, credit, and money. And before I start with that, just remind us all what has been the state of mainstream economics, so the new consensus macroeconomics before the crisis. Now, new consensus macroeconomics had accepted that the stock of money is no longer the control or the instrument variable of the central bank. So this is why you have to distinguish new consensus macroeconomics from old monetarism. And instead of assuming that the central bank can control high-powered money, the assumption is that the central bank can control the interest rate. But there's only one interest rate. So there is no financial sector in the new consensus model, at least in the versions we've seen before the crisis. Now there are attempts at integrating financial institutions in a kind of supply-side argument, so introducing frictions into the model. But before the crisis, there was almost nothing. So you had a central bank, you had an interest rate, but you did not have any financial sector in the model. There was implicitly endogenous money, but it was not shown how exactly money and credit have become endogenous. And this is the great advantage of post-Keynesian economics, because post-Keynesian economics right from, well, I would say since the 50s, in particular since the 70s with the work of Kaldor, and then Basil Moore and others, Philip Orestes again has contributed to that, have argued that money and credit are endogenous, and if the central bank has a control or an instrument variable, it's the short-term rate of interest. Marc Lavoie, in his first edition of his textbook, has famously summarized this post-Keynesian notion of money, interest, and credit, arguing that money, from a post-Keynesian view, is credit-driven. Loans make deposits. Deposits make reserves. The supply of and the demand for credit money are interdependent. The control instrument of the central bank is not a quantity, but the price, the rate of interest. Now, this means post-Keynesians, in their models, or in their discussion about the monetary economics, always have a central bank and they have commercial banks. At least they have two types of markets in their model, a money market or an interbank market, and a financial or a credit market. And what they have examined is the interaction of these two markets. The basic model, which I used to, and some of my students have seen that or will see that, I'm using and teaching at the Bern School of Economics, is just to assume we have a central bank and we have commercial banks, and then we have a private sector. And then central banks set the base interest rate. They define the standards of creditworthiness because commercial banks get central bank money from the central bank in exchange for collateral, and the central bank therefore defines the criteria for this collateral, which it is willing to accept in exchange for central bank money. Then the central bank supplies central bank money to commercial banks, accepting securities in exchange as collateral, and the central bank acts as a lender of last resort for the system as a whole, for the banks, but as has become obvious during the recent crisis, also for the government. And that is where the modern charteralist idea, the idea of the proponents of modern money theory, come in. Commercial banks mark up central bank's base rate. They are supposed to check the creditworthiness of firms and households and then supply to credit to those firms and households whom they consider to be creditworthy. In a functioning monetary and financial system. Of course, we have seen in the recent crisis, this has been seriously violated, in particular by means of introducing on a wide scale instruments like securitization, etc. So therefore, credit and money are endogenously determined by the economic process. The interest rate is exogenous and can be considered as a distributional parameter for income generation and the growth process. There's been a whole lot of debate about how exactly we should think about that in post-Keynesian economics, a debate between the so-called accommodationist or horizontalist and the structuralist. You might have come across this debate. I won't go into that because I think this has been a storm in a teacup. We have wasted far too much resources on that. This is the figure I usually use in my teaching. It's drawing on work or on what Tom Pally, I think, has used. No, whether he's used it first, but he has used it. Giuseppe Fontana has used it and others, which in a stylized way represents the post-Keynesian endogenous money, endogenous credit view. So what you have on the upper left quadrant is the interbank market, the money market. The central bank sets the base rate, and providing that commercial banks have securities, have collateral, it supplies commercial banks at this base rate with high-powered money, with the central bank money. But that is not where the causality starts. The causality starts on the upper right, which is the credit or the financial market, in which we have credit supply by commercial banks, marking up the base rate of interest so that you have a long run or credit market rate of interest. The market itself determined by several factors, cost of banking, competition in the banking sector, liquidity and risk assessments of the banks, etc. And then you have credit demand, and here we have two curves. The outer right curve is the notional credit demand, which is the credit demand from the perspective of the households and the firms who, given their expectations, would like to obtain a certain amount of credit at a certain rate of interest. However, not all of them are considered to be credit worthy from the perspective of the commercial banks. And therefore, you have the effective credit demand curve, which is the LD curve, and this is the amount of credit which will be granted at a certain rate of interest by the commercial banks. And you see, the post-Keynesian view on this system already includes the notion of credit rationing. So at the IB rate of interest, you have a certain amount of credit demand which will not be satisfied by the banks, although firms and households would like to obtain this amount of credit at this rate IB, but there is the difference between the two intersections of the curves with this supply curve, which is not considered to be credit worthy from the perspective of the banks. So you have a post-Keynesian view on credit rationing. Martin Wolfson has a paper on that, I think, in the mid-80s in the Journal of Post-Keynesian Economics. If you then move on, you have the point of intersection of these two curves then determines the volume of credit in our economy. So it's credit demand and credit supply given by the commercial banks. And there's been a long discussion in post-Keynesian economics whether this credit supply curve should be horizontal or whether it should be upward sloping. Some have argued it should be upward sloping because if you expand credit, liquidity of the banking sector will dry out, and degree of risk banks take will rise. However, the question is, what exactly are we showing here? Are we showing the credit supply curve of an individual bank, or are we showing the credit supply curve for the banking sector as a whole? And there's been a large literature, large discussion, what exactly is that? And depending on what you intend to show, you may come to different conclusions with respect to the slope of this credit supply curve. Therefore, I would argue, if we take the macro perspective on that, it's good first approximation to take this credit supply curve as horizontal. Then you have the LD curve, which is the loan deposit curve, which means loans make deposits, and only if you have the deposits, if you have the money, so to speak, on the accounts of the firms and the households, then they can spend it. So loans make deposits, and then depending on the structural characteristics of your financial system, depending on the degree to which firms and households use money in their expenditures, or to the extent to which they may use credit cards, the extent to which you have indeed still use cash in order to do your daily transactions, and the extent to which the central bank demands commercial banks to hold money with the central bank, we have the money demand curve. Yeah? So money is the result of that whole process. The starting point is the credit market. And if banks have behaved properly, if banks have only granted credit to creditworthy borrowers, then the central bank can easily supply them with the required amount of high-powered money. But even if banks have failed to do so, as they have in the recent crisis, central banks nonetheless supply the liquidity to the system in order to avoid a systemic breakdown. That's the lender of last resort function of the central bank. Now, what is the, let me make the final argument and then we have may have a round of questions. What is the implication of that? Now, the implication is that the central bank basically has two, maybe three instruments to affect the credit market and in an indirect way to affect the goods market and the level of economic activity. The first instrument is changing the base rate of interest. But there are limits to that. They can raise the base rate of interest to infinity, but you have a lower bound for the base rate of interest, the lending rate of the central bank, which is zero. Second, if you raise the rate of interest, it means that commercial banks at some point have to follow, because they need a margin in order to cover cost and to make a profit. Therefore, raising the rate of the base rate of interest will always trigger an increase in the central bank in the credit market rate of interest, and will therefore affect credit demand. Lowering the base rate of interest, lowering the money market rate of interest, might not, at least not immediately, cause a fall in the credit market rate. We've seen that in the recent financial crisis. Therefore, there is a built-in asymmetry already at this stage. Central banks can always choke a boom or choke investment by means of raising interest rates, but they cannot push the economy out of a recession because there is the zero lower bound for the base rate of interest, and commercial banks may not necessarily adjust. Second, you have the question, well, what you can affect is the rate of interest, but you have no direct effect on the volume of credit. The credit demand is given by the demand of private actors. Now, in a recession, although you may be able to lower even the credit market rate of interest, if your credit demand curve shifts inwards, you may not be able to stimulate the economy. So a second problem which we have in the transmission process, a problem which you are well aware of, because that is what is in textbook is called the investment trap. What else can central banks do? Well, they can't, if commercial banks do not follow lowering the base rate of interest such that the credit market rate of interest or the rate of interest in financial markets is rigid. Now, what central banks can try to do, they can try to directly intervene into financial markets. This is what we have seen for many years now. This is what is called quantitative easing. Quantitative easing is, in essence, an attempt of central banks to lower the credit market rate of interest, and it's an attempt at circumventing, in a sense, the commercial banks. Well, you may be able to do so. However, you're still facing the problem that lowering the rate of interest may not stimulate investment. It's like pushing on a string. And that is one of the reasons why quantitative easing has failed so far in terms of stimulating our economies. Your question.
I was wondering, in this diagram, this framework, where would you fit? It seems like there's only one type of liability, deposits, and there's central bank funding can be a perfect substitute for deposits, as you explained. But it seems really like the liability structure does not really matter much for the banking system. It doesn't matter at all. Right.
Thank you. Hello? Yeah. Now, I was wondering, in this diagram, this framework, it seems that basically the liability structure of the banking system does not really matter, does not really play a role, because there's only one source of funding, deposits, one type of liability, deposits. All the other possible types of liabilities on central bank funding or alternative source of funding are basically perfect substitutes of deposits. So where does, for example, capital or liabilities that represent capital as a specific source of funding fit in this framework? And do they play any role at all or absolutely none?
They do not explicitly show up here in this framework, and I would argue capital requirements are a type of regulation which you impose on a commercial bank to have access, so to speak, to central bank money, but it has nothing to do whatsoever with the ability of the central bank to the ability and the requirement of the central bank to stabilize the system by means of acting as a lender of last resort, if this is your question. But we can discuss that. It's not in here. It's not in here.
But it shouldn't be either. You think it doesn't really play an important enough role to be...
The point which I would make is that this applies to a system in which we have an interbank market, in which we have banks which fulfill basic requirements being set by the regulation either by some financial authority or the regulation by the central bank. And that is where your arguments come in. Yeah? Okay. So this is just summarizing what I've said. Let me move to the second topic in post-Keynesian economics, the link of income distribution with the principle of effective demand in the short run. Here, and I draw here on a paper of mine which is already available as a working paper and which will come out as a chapter in the Handbook of Heterodox Economics, edited by three younger colleagues. So if we look at the principle of effective demand, it's not particularly post-Keynesian, I would argue. You can also find something of that in Karl Marx, in particular in Capital Volume 2 and in the theories of surplus value, where Marx takes issue with Say's law in the theories of surplus value. In Capital Volume 2, he has the schemes of simple and explanatory production, which already include the Marxian principle of effective demand. But it mainly, post-Keynesians mainly draw on the work of Mikhail Kaletsky, 1932, and then republished or revised and republished in the theory of economic dynamics, and then Keynes's general theory. Now, in my working paper and the book chapter, you will find an overview of all three approaches, and I will also single out the differences. Let me focus here on the Kaletsky approach, which I consider to be the most convincing, and let me show you in a very simple model how the principle of effective demand can be linked with income distribution and give rise to at least two of the paradoxes which we've seen in my first overview, namely the paradox of saving and the paradox of cost, or the paradox of thrift and the paradox of cost. So we apply now this endogenous money and credit approach. This allows us to have our system driven by the principle of effective demand, in particular by investment, because firms can draw on financial resources being generated in an endogenous credit and money framework. There doesn't have to be any prior saving, which would allow firms to invest. We have a closed economy without a government. We don't look at intermediate products, so in a sense we assume vertical integrated sectors. We have an investment goods sector, a consumption goods sector for workers, and a consumption goods sector for capitalists. Pricing prices are being set in an oligopolistic framework, so we have markup pricing. And we have a fixed coefficient technology, so we have constant unit variable cost and therefore constant prices up to full capacity output. Now, this is how Kolesky explains his principle of effective demand. So he starts with an accounting identity for this closed economy without a government. On the one hand, you have the distribution perspective on national income, which is wages plus profits. On the other hand, you have the use perspective. So national income is being used for consumption out of wages, consumption out of profits, plus investment. So this is an accounting identity, which is always true, or convention, which is always true. Now, if you rearrange this equation, you have equation 5, in which you have profits on the left-hand side, and consumption plus investment minus savings of workers on the right-hand side. Then you can make a simplifying assumption, the simplifying assumption being that workers just spend what they get. Now then, equation 5 simplifies to equation 6, which tells you that profits are equal to consumption plus investment. Still derived from a convention, an accounting convention. Now the question is, how do we get a theory from that? And Kolesky is quite explicit. And this is the quote which I've taken from this 1954 book, arguing, now it is clear that capitalists may decide to consume or to invest more in a given period than in the preceding one, but they cannot decide to earn more. It is therefore their investment and consumption decisions which determine profits and not vice versa. And the same conclusion basically can be derived from Marx's schemes of reproduction. So it's the expenditure of the capitalist which determine their profits. Or using Caldo's paraphrase, workers spend what they get, capitalists get what they spend. If you now manipulate these equations a bit, so you introduce a constant propensity to consume out of profits, insert this into your equation 6, then you have a kind of Kolesky-ian profit multiplier, which tells you that profits are equal to investment multiplied by 1 divided by the propensity to save out of profit. And then if you insert the profit share into equation 8 again, the profit share being profits over national income, you have a Kolesky-ian multiplier equation relating investment to income, which includes both the paradox of saving and the paradox of cost. As you can easily see, if capitalists decide to save more, income will go down. If you increase the profit share through an increase in the markup, income will go down. So you have both a macroeconomic paradox of thrift and a macroeconomic paradox of cost. So because raising the profit share means lowering the wage share, which means that unit wage costs go down. And therefore, costs go down, and the reduction in cost leads to a reduction in income in this case. You could now want to argue that, well, this is very simple, a model, because we still take investment as exogenous. So we don't have a theory of investment. And that is where I would like to expand the model. We take basically the same model, but now we introduce a theory of investment into the model. And we have different theories in post-Keynesian economics. We could go back to Keynes and argue that investment is determined by the marginal efficiency of capital and by the monetary rate of interest. However, this theory, as Kolesky already in the 1930s has claimed, has several deficiencies and several problems. And therefore, I rather employ a more Kolesky-ian theory of investment into a very simple post-Keynesian short-run model. The assumptions are basically the same, but now we have to include finance into the model because, according to Kolesky, finance is relevant when it comes to determining investment. So again, the same setup, closed economy without a government, workers and managers, and we have rentiers, so those supplying finance, the banking sector, if you like, or those who are holding financial wealth and being able to grant credit to the firm sector. Firms produce to workers, and interest on credit to the rentiers, and they retain part of the profits. Workers, again, don't save. The rentiers receive interest income, and they partly consume this income, and partly they save this income. And since... Can I do anything? And if... Could you take care of that? And since we only have one financial asset in this simple model, again, you can make the model more complicated, you can introduce two or three assets. We only have one financial asset, which is credit here in this model. Saving means granting credit. Equation 15 is the pricing equation, which is just price, the markup over unit labor cost. The markup determines, as you see in equation 16, the profit share in this simple model. Equation 17 is the saving equation of the model. And saving is now composed of two elements. It's retained earnings, so the profits which are not paid out to the rentiers, retained earnings, and it's the interest being paid to the rentiers. You could easily add other assets to the model, stocks, and then you would have dividends in the model and so on. But that's a simple version just to show you the basic principles. So this means saving has these two components. So it's composed of retained profits and the saving out of the rentier's income. So the rate of interest multiplied by the stock of credit or the stock of debt from the firm perspective. And now we add the investment function to the model. The investment function, which is equation 18, which is a Kaletskian investment function because it contains two major elements of Kaletsky's thought. So first, the first thing is that investment is determined by sales, or more precisely by expected sales. So investment is determined by income as a proxy. Second, investment firms cannot get all the credit they like. Why not? Well, because they have to be creditworthy from the perspective of the financial wealth holders, from the perspective of the banks, for instance. Now, what is the indicator of creditworthiness? Well, Kaletsky argues it's the own means of finance which firms can present to the bank or so. So the own means of finance, or the own stock of finance, which the firm can make use of. This is the famous Kaletskian principle of increasing risk. So it says that the size of the firm, the size of investment, and therefore if you accumulate investment, the size of the firm depends on the own means of finance of the firm, because firms are faced with an incomplete, if you like, credit market in which own means of finance are an indicator of credit worthiness. Now, how can we implement this in this simple model? Well, we have a determinant, which is the theta IB, which tells you that the more firms pay out in terms of profits, the less they have as returned earnings, and therefore profits distributed to the rentiers, in this case interest payments, have a negative effect on your investment. And then, of course, we have animal spirits. That's the Keynesian element, but it's not foreign to Kaletsky, which is the first of the IA in the investment function. So then you have your goods market equilibrium, you have your stability condition, the usual stuff. You can calculate your equilibrium. And then if you do the comparative statics, what you see is, that's not no surprise at all. With an investment function, you still have the paradox of saving. So if the propensity to save now of the rentiers goes up, it means that income will go down. Second, you find that your economy is wage-led. So if you raise the profit share, it means that you have lower income. Well, this has slipped in through the investment function, because in the investment function, the profit share as such is no direct determinant. And that, again, this is following Kaletsky. Kaletsky and the old Kaletskians, people like Kazimierz Leski or Jerzy Ojatinski, they quite forcefully argue that introducing a profit share into the investment function is not Kaletskin. There's a debate about that. We'll talk about that tonight, about wage and profit-led growth, because if you can have profit-led demand and profit-led growth if you change your investment function. But in Kaletsky, if we want to be faithful to Kaletsky, we would use this function. And this means you always have wage-led demand. And regarding your effect of changes in the interest rate, you again come up with a mixed conclusion. So the first two conclusions are unique, unambiguous. You come up with a mixed conclusion, because if you change the rate of interest, what you're doing now is you redistribute income. You distribute income from the firms who do not consume to the rentiers who at least partly consume their income. And therefore, a rise in the rate of interest in the short run with a stock of debt given, a rise in the rate of interest has no unique effect on aggregate demand and therefore not on income and output. It all depends on the propensities to spend of the rentiers and the firms. Now, if the rentiers spend a whole lot out of their interest payments and the firms are hardly affected by internal means of finance, the investment of the firm is hardly affected, so the theta is very low, then a rising interest rate may have a positive effect on aggregate demand and output, assuming the second term in the numerator to be zero. So let's don't talk about this here. However, if the reverse, this is what Marc Lavoie in 1995 called the puzzling case. So the puzzling case meaning that, and this is again something which you hardly found in other basic textbook models, mainstream textbook models. There you usually have, if you raise the rate of interest, aggregate demand will go down. But nobody asked the question, well, where do the interest, does the interest income go to? And what happens to the interest income? And here, if we follow that, you may have, at least in theory, this puzzling case in which a rising rate of interest may trigger rising demand. If the opposite holds true, so if theta is rather large, and the propensity to save out of rentiers' income is high, then you get the usual normal case which we would expect from the traditional, also post-Keynesian view, but also from our textbooks. Okay, here I have the same exercise for investment, basically the same results. What I want to draw your attention to is the effects of changing parameters on the equilibrium volume of profits. Equilibrium profits is equation 23. If you now do again the comparative statics, what you see is that an increase in the propensity to save also leads to lower profits. Well, firms or capitalists earn what they spend. If capitalists decide to spend less, they earn less. So this is no surprise. And you also have now a clear definition of the paradox of cost, which tells you that if you raise the profit share, equilibrium profits will go down. How come? Well, if you raise the profit share, it means aggregate demand will go down. And therefore, this will also have a negative effect. If you look at your investment function, it will also negatively affect investment through the accelerated term in the investment functions, through the beta y term. And therefore, if you have that, you have a precise definition of the paradox of costs. Unit profits go up, unit wage costs go down, but aggregate profits go down. That's a clear paradox which we've now shown formally to hold. Regarding the effect of the rate of interest, again, you may have different cases. Well, you can now further develop this model. You could include, we haven't talked about inflation yet. You could include inflation into the model. Post-Keynesians would do that by means of introducing a conflict over income between capitalists and workers. and then you can analyze the joint model and the interaction between this income generation and the inflation generation process. Those of you who are interested in that, we've done that with Engelbert Stockheimer in two or three papers at different levels. I haven't talked about debt dynamics in this model because I've shown you just a short-run model with a constant stock of debt. But of course, this is something which needs to be expanded. So you would have to include debt dynamics into the model if you move from the short run to the medium to the long run. Because if you grant additional credit to the firms, their debt will go up, and it's interesting to trace the effects on the model. If you're interested in that, I've done that in a book and also in my recent book in chapter 9. Maybe I skip that. Any questions on the short run model? I mean, I have in the PowerPoint also the implications for policies, but since I will talk about that tonight, maybe I skip this here, unless you're interested in that. And we are running against the time constraint anyway, so we still have 10 minutes. We started late. Any questions on that? Okay, then let me just give you a brief notion of my third area, or third main topic of post-Keynesian economics, which is income distribution and the principle of effective demand in the long run. That's a famous quote by Joan Robinson, who argues that the principle of effective demand should hold also in the long run, and that is the unifying characteristics of all post-Keynesian long-run models. So each of them would argue that firms are free, quoting John Robinson, within wide limits to accumulate as they please, and that the rate of saving of the economy as a whole accommodates itself to the rate of investment that they decree. Now, there have been two types of models, which I've already touched upon in my brief overview. In the 50s, we have the Caldor and Robinson and Pasinetti models, Pasinetti rather in the 60s, in which the argument was that the adaption or the adjustment of saving towards investment in the long run takes place via income distribution. So firms invest more, and you have different propensities to save out of wages and out of profits, as in the models which I've shown you. I've assumed that the propensity to save out of wages is zero. The propensity to save out of profits is a positive number. Now, if investment goes up, or the rate of capital accumulation goes up in the long run, but you're operating at a normal rate, or full rate of capacity utilization, not full employment, but capacity utilization given by the capital stock, then the only way of redistributing income is taking income from the workers. The only way of the adjusting saving to investment is taking income from the workers and giving it, so to speak, to the capitalist. How does this take place? Well, you have to assume, and this is done in these models, that you have more or less rigid nominal wages and flexible prices. So in this case, you're operating at full capacity utilization, investment goes up, or the rate of investment goes up, therefore aggregate demand goes up, firms cannot produce more, or cannot produce output at a higher speed, and therefore prices start rising, wages remain rigid, and you have a redistribution of income, which will allow you to adjust saving to investment. Now, you see that there is a fundamental assumption in this model. The fundamental assumption is, for this process to work, that prices have to be more flexible than nominal wages. Now, this is not, at least not to me, a very convincing assumption, looking at the long run, talking about long run models. So why should prices be more flexible than wages? Therefore, therefore I am more inclined with the second version of the post-Keynesian distribution and growth theory, which is the Kolesky-Steindl model. In these models, you assume that firms have still some room of maneuver to expand production or to increase the speed of production also in the long run, assuming that the degree of capacity utilization in the long run is not necessarily the normal one. Income distribution is here determined by markup pricing, as I've shown, and therefore here the adjustment of saving to investment in the long run takes place via a higher speed of production and a higher rate of utilization of productive capacities. Let us briefly compare these two models in a stylized way such that you see the difference. And again, I've done so in a working paper, and a shorter version will come out in the review of Keynesian economics next year. It's a pedagogical, so to speak, introduction into different versions of growth models. This is an issue celebrating the 25th anniversary of the publication of the Baduri modeling model. Anyway, so the model which I would just briefly like to introduce to you is, again, a closed economy, one good model without a government. We have now two classes, workers and capitalists. For a moment, we don't look at finance. We just assume that this takes place in the background. Workers receive wages, don't save. Capitalists own the means of production and receive profits, which are partly consumed and partly saved. No depreciation, no overhead labor. Equation one is the rate of profit, and shows you the decomposition of the rate of profit in the profit share, the rate of utilization, and the capital to potential output ratio, so the HU1 over V, V being the capital potential output ratio. Equation two is the saving rate, not the propensity to save, but the saving rate, so it's saving over the normal capital stock, and since workers don't save, we only have saving out of profits, and therefore the saving rate is just the product of the propensity to save out of profits and the rate of profit. Then we can decompose the rate of profit as you see in equation two. So this is just the basic structure of the model. And then we can close the model using a notion which has, I think, been introduced by Sen and then in particular used by Stephen Market in his book 1984. We can close the model by different assumptions. And different behavioral functions. And this is the Caldwell-Robinson closure, which tells you, well, in the long run, utilization is at some normal rate. So output or utilization in the long run should be at this rate and not deviate from that, because otherwise you don't have a long-run equilibrium. We have a fixed coefficient technology, production technology, so the capital potential output ratio is fixed. Then you have an investment function in this model. Going back to John Robinson in particular, but I think you also find this in Caldwell's 57 growth model, is that investment is determined by a constant alpha, which you may want to interpret as animal spirits, and then by the rate of profit, or more precisely by the expected rate of profit. And then you have your equilibrium condition. The equilibrium condition is that, well, saving has to be equal to investment in the long run. Your adjusting or endogenous variables are then the profit share, the rate of profit, and the rate of accumulation, as you can easily see here. In this two-quadrant figure you have on the right-hand side, you have the rate of accumulation, G, at the saving rate. On the left-hand side, you have the rate of profit and the profit share. And now you can easily see if, for instance, animal spirits would go up, your investment function shifts outwards, and what you get, according to this model, is a higher rate of profit and a higher profit share because you have this redistributive mechanism. Yeah? You can also show, and I don't have time to go into that, you can show that the propensity, that the paradox of saving will hold in this model. So if you increase the propensity to save, this will have a negative effect on all endogenous variables. So that's the Caldwell-Robinson model. Let us look at the alternative, the Kolesky-Steinberg closure. Here you have a theory of distribution, which is income distribution is determined by the markup. You have your constant coefficient production technology. You have an investment function, which is now a bit more complicated because you disaggregate the rate of profit into its component, the profit share, the rate of utilization, and the rate and the capital output ratio. You see the partial derivatives in this equation. And then you have your equilibrium condition. Here, as you have the endogenous variables, the rate of utilization, the rate of profit, and the rate of capital accumulation. So the same figure, the only difference here is now that the endogenous or the adjusting variable is not the profit share, but is the rate of utilization. Yeah? And now you can, if you like, play around with this model. So this is, again, the comparative statics or dynamics, if you like. You can play around with this model, and you can show that you may have different cases for the effects of changes in income distribution. And this all depends on the coefficients in your saving and investment function. Now, this is the first case, which is the so-called wage-led growth case. So here, we reduce the profit share in the Kolesky-Steiner model, and we move from our initial equilibrium. We move from our initial equilibrium, which is here, to this equilibrium. And this is also associated with a higher rate of profit and also with a higher rate of utilization, because here firms do not respond at all to changes in the profit share. So the coefficient of the profit share in the investment function is more or less, or it's close to zero. And therefore, you have the effect which I've also shown for the static model, or for the short-run model. You redistribute income in favor of workers. This means higher demand, higher utilization, and this then stimulates investment. So now, I think I made the point. Then you may have a kind of intermediate case in which you have a slightly negative effect of the profit share on investment. However, this effect is not strong enough to overcompensate the expansionary effect of redistribution in terms of output. And this is what you see here. If you compare your two equilibria, you now have a lower rate of accumulation, but still a higher rate of utilization. So this is wage-led demand with profit-led growth. So in the short run, you stimulate your economy, but the long-run effect on growth will be negative because you have already a strong effect, a relevant effect of the profit share on your investment function. Now you can easily see what happens if you have a strong effect on your investment function. This is what you see here, and then you may have profit-led demand, so lower utilization, and profit-led growth. So basically you may have three regimes: a wage-led demand, wage-led growth regime, an intermediate regime, or a profit-led demand, profit-led growth regime. If you look at estimations, and maybe my last slide anyway. If you look at the estimation of these demand regimes, this is a table which I've taken from my recent book. You find that by and large, if you have a closed economy model, our economies are usually wage-led, because the effect of redistribution on consumption is usually stronger than the counter effect, so to speak, on investment. There are a few exceptions from that, but these are rather country specifics, or maybe older work using not such refined econometric techniques, whatever. So, but the broad result is domestic demand is wage-led. However, if you add exports and imports, which I have not done in the simple model, but if you do so, then in particular for small open economies, aggregate demand might turn profit-led. You see that in particular for the case of Switzerland. We have that for the case of Austria. Part of Netherlands is a bit unclear. So these are the two examples which you have here. So small open economies might then turn profit-led. Well, this is result. Of course, this is just a first step. You can work on that. You could include technical change, productivity growth. You can explicitly, in this growth model, include money and finance, rate of interest. If you're interested in that, take a look at my 2014 book. You will find models on that and also empirical results on that, and you will also find further reading on that. Thank you very much.